broadcasting from the depths of outer space.
Say now.
By your command.
God damn you all to hell!
Indeed.
This is the Solo Sci-Fi Podcast.
This is episode 44 of the Solo One Sci-Fi Podcast. Mike, a.k.a. CoCloud on YouTube, is on with you again with Martin, a.k.a. Martin Sci-Fi Appeal on YouTube as well. For another show, just talking about anything to do with the world of science fiction and basically just having a bit of a laugh. Hello, Martin. How are you doing?
I'm all right. Yeah, I'm good. I sent you the noises of the universe.
Oh, the noises of the universe.
God's pillar, the pillars of God.
Okay.
It popped up today and they've got like the noises. I just wondered if you'd put them in. It's like what the noises in outer space. It should be in your message box.
Okay. Well, because my computer's freezing up, let's just see how you are first of all, then I'll play that in a second once my computer stops working.
Yeah, so how are you?
I'm all right. Yeah, fine. Sort of weather's changing now. It's sort of becoming more autumnal.
Yes.
This is released on the 1st of October, which is quite surprising. But then, getting this year done is a priority for me, really. I think we just want to get this year and just think of it as a bit of a bad dream.
But yes.
No, we're fine. I'm fine. How about you? What's been happening with you?
I'm good. I'm quite ecstatic that in another week or so we'll be able to watch Star Trek Discovery and The Mandalorian.
Oh, brilliant.
Each week. And I'd just like to say we will be doing a live show or recorded panel.
Yep.
On the Friday. When's it? On the 16th, isn't it?
Yeah, so we've got 2 more weeks of Star Trek Lower Decks. And then it's the week after. So we've got 2 more weeks of that. How are you finding Lower Decks? Are you enjoying that?
I'm building them up. I'm waiting for the next episode to appear mysteriously on my monitor. And then I will review all 3 episodes together.
Okay, because obviously, I think that the last two, it's a two-parter, apparently. So that could be interesting.
That's the one with Q, isn't it?
Oh, no. Well, no, he's already made it. He makes a brief appearance. I don't know if he comes back. But he's appeared in one of the more recent episodes.
Have you seen him then? Have you seen him?
Yeah, he's in it. And he doesn't sound John DeLancey, although it's Q, he doesn't quite sound like Q that much. Maybe because the actor's voice is obviously his age, so he's not quite the. But it is Q, but he's a very, very brief. It's a couple of brief scenes that you see him in, but I won't say too much about it. It's not like it's a full blown Q episode, which is what you would have thought that they would have done. So no, don't get your hopes up about that. It's not
the word they were advertising it, the what?
Well, unless he comes back in the season finale as a more of a main sort of situation with him, or I don't know. All I know is that he appeared briefly, but it's not something which is like the most exciting thing you've ever encountered in your life.
I was really stoked up for that.
Yeah, I was.
Destroyed it for me. I've just given up now.
Oh well, I
took that away from me.
Well, they're going to try to sort of like pull you in, aren't they, to make you watch it and stuff. But in the end, you know, it's I do like Lower Decks, but it's I'm not a big fan of cartoons. So, but for what I did do this week, I did 3D print a USS Cerritos. What's the name of their ship?
Cerritos.
Yeah. Cerritos. Yeah, I've got that. I've got a small one of those. It's quite nice, and it's.
I'm really upset about that. I wanted the whole episode with Q up to his usual mischief and stuff.
Well, they tend to sort of make it like the Lower Decks characters are kind of got their own problems, and the main crew are sort of tackling things, but we just don't see them. That's the point. It's not about Lower Decks. It is not about the main crew. It's about the Lower Decks. So, but I don't know. I don't know. I mean, apparently I've heard rumours that the next 2 episodes are the biggest episodes and maybe give you a bit more. Now we know the characters after 10 episodes.
Yes.
Maybe they'll try to sort of stretch things a bit and make it a little bit more kind of like...
Well, I'm just building them up and then I'm going to review like the last few episodes.
Yeah, I'd like to watch that. That'd be cool.
Yeah.
I think it's been a good series. I have enjoyed it. You know, like I said, I'm more into live action stuff, really, which is why I've still not seen the entire Star Trek TAS. I've still not seen. I've seen the odd episode, And I'm the world's biggest Star Trek fan, but I've never sat down and watched every episode. Have you seen every episode of the animated series?
What, the original one?
Yeah, the original one, yeah.
Yeah, years ago, it's all right. I mean, I don't think I could really get into it now.
No, that's what I'm saying.
It's all right. It's just, it doesn't really rock the boat, really, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know. It's just...
Yeah, it doesn't never sort of click with me.
Somebody did a two-part episode in anime. It's very good, actually. I can send you, it's like 2 hours long in two parts. They've based it on the original crew and they go to this planet and it's all animated. And the guy who put it together did a really good job of it, actually. It's quite good.
Did you see the new...
Paradise Lost.
Paradise Lost. Did you see the fan film? I can't remember if I asked you about it last week. The First Frontier thing with Captain...
No, I've got it. Oh, ready to watch. I've got such a backlist.
No, that's all right. I'm nagging you about The Mist. And I'm nagging
is
you
it
about
any
this.
Good? Is it up there with Star Trek Continues, would you say?
No, I wouldn't, actually. I liked it, but there were some issues. First of all, the sound levels are atrocious. You can hear bits of machinery and things humming and you can hear like fans going. The levels are, I actually sent them a message because I know enough about sound editing. I said, look, if you want me to, and I could do this easily, I could balance out all those sound levels. I could reduce the noise and hum and all everything else. And I could really, of course, they've not replied. And they probably thought, who's this guy saying that? But I know I could actually make their... When you watch it, listen for the sound levels because they are all over the place. Sometimes they're really quiet. Sometimes the music drowns them out. It wouldn't take long to fix.
Do you know, I'm going to call you.
What?
I'm going to come out of a classic track line now. You're a miracle worker.
You said something about that last week to our Trekker Prize when he came on. You said I was a bit like Scott. No, I mean, like I said, I'm an amateur. I mean, all the stuff I've learned is self-taught. I've not been to... But I'm a bit of a perfectionist with things like soundness levels and stuff like that. And
I understand that.
When you watch it, you're here, and you're because I mean, you might not have even noticed it. Although I did see a lot of other people did see it as well, you know. And it's so I could do that in about a day. I could go through the levels with Gold Wave and whatever or Audacity, muck about the sound levels, add some stereo, reduce the noise and bits and like that, and you can really patch it up. And then remix it with the MP4 video file, and it'd be fine, it'd be sorted.
Is Audacity still free?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I've had it so long now. I can't remember where I got it from. I don't know if it's free now, but I mean, I've got an old copy.
Yeah.
But, I mean, I do the majority of my work on Gold Wave, which is I've used that for 20 years. But Audacity I use for things like sound effects and reverb, and I do the levels. When we do the podcast, I level out the actual things to make it otherwise, you know. And it's just one of those things that I should have been in radio, really. I'd like to have been in radio in some ways. I'd like to have done that. But I could do it as a hobby.
Well, I'd have had you on as my sound producer.
I would have considered that a compliment. I'd love to have worked with you. That would have been great. But thank you. That's very kind of you to even suggest that. But I like it as a hobby. And like I said, you know, podcasting is something and stuff like that. But yeah. So if you see First Frontier, so I'm going off on a tangent here.
Right, I will.
It's all right. It's okay. It's okay. Some of it's model work, and it doesn't. I'm getting quite used to the standards of the special effects from things like New Voyages and Continues, and some of the special effects aren't up to that level. It's all right. It's a good idea, and I, like I said, it's just that there's a few little basic things they could have done which would really give. And also they use the Star Trek II theme, and Star Trek II. That the theme from that era, that's sort of like the James Horner era.
Yeah.
That really, to me, is post... That's ahead of Star... That's the end of the original series. That's into the films. And it seems to be a bit shoehorned into this prequel with Captain April. And I thought to myself... And there's scenes where you remember, like, where Khan's on the Reliant and it's spinning out of control and it's going to blow up and everything like that. And... I don't know, some of it just didn't quite work. I don't know. See what you think. I mean, you might like it more than I did like it, but I think they could have I would have done the soundtrack differently myself, but that's just me. Right, so shall we go into the news, unless there's anything else you want to say?
Yeah, let's go into the news.
Let's go for it. Here we go.
Working. Solar Sci-Fi News.
All right, I haven't got anything hardy at all, so tell me what you got.
Right, Supergirl finishes on season 6. I know you don't watch it, but I'm just bored.
Yeah, no, go for it.
Supergirl, yeah, it's coming to an end on season 6. And, well, I don't think I'm really going to miss it, really. It's started off okay, and then it got a bit...
It got a bit
preaching in your face.
I saw the Supergirl original movie with around the time that Christopher Reeve was doing his ones. And I thought that was quite good. I quite liked the movie.
My mother loved that movie.
Oh, did she? Oh, that's nice. And there was even there's a nice scene where she actually sees like a picture of Superman because she's around the same time that he's around. And I thought it was quite a good movie. I like the soundtrack.
Originally, they were going to team them both up, weren't they?
I don't know. Were they?
Originally. If you look into it, yeah, originally, but there was some problem or something and that. But the cast in it, that was superb.
Yeah. Was it Peter O'Toole, wasn't it? Something like that?
Peter O'Toole.
Yeah, Peter O'Toole, wasn't it?
The stunning actress, I forgot her name now. She's a legend. Faye Dunaway.
But like I said, I mean, so did this TV series just finishing? Did it have a similar premise to the movie, or was it something? Obviously, it wasn't linked.
It's Alan. She comes from Krypton, and she flies around every week, and then there's like a political message at the end of each episode, and you know,
Sort of a bit too much in your face with the messages every week, kind of thing?
But it sort of started in later seasons, and then I just stopped watching it. But it's like, you know, where you get these like American TV set where they're all like 25 and they all hang out in a coffee shop, and then one of them's like the head of a corporation, and they're like 20 years wiser than what they should be, and they're all good looking.
Yeah, all perfect, aren't they?
But they all care about people and care about the city they live in. And it's like, for God's sake, I want like that at 25. You know what I mean?
No, I know. I mean, it's like I was sort of a bit, I didn't know what I was doing at 25. I still don't know what I'm doing at 47.
She has a big fan base, and I suppose, you know, she's 20 years from now, she'd be like Wonder Woman, you know, but it'd be like Supergirl, won't it? You know, so.
Yeah. It's like I said, you know, I remember the different versions of Super. I mean, I remember Lois and Clark, The New Adventures. You must have remembered that. Yes, did you like that?
I did watch some of that
with Terry Hatcher.
I quite enjoyed that, you know.
That was all right.
The trouble, what killed that one when he started going out with her.
Yeah, you know, that's
the minute
that,
they started, when they'd done the deed. And,
that's the whole point.
They just over, because the old, before that, the sexual tension between would they or wouldn't they?
That's the whole crux of the show. It
did leave you quite sort of hooked, you know, and that's what made it work. The minute they crossed the line, it just
sort of fizzled out. It's strange that. But like I said, it's interesting how they, you know, like Superman and Supergirl, and you know how there have been so many iterations of those
Well,
characters.
She's back in it because I think she's had a baby or something, and she wants to become a mum, which is fair enough.
And
she's had a good 6 years out of it. So
it's not bad for a show, is it? It's quite a long time for a series. Oh well, I hope that you know, I hope it's got its fan base, and that.
But we have the replacement show. Superman and Lois is coming.
Superman and Lewis, or Lois?
Lois.
Is this like a woke Superman? Superman and Lewis?
Yeah, it will be,
I do apologise for that slightly, completely incorrect comment then. Who's in that? Anybody that we know? Anybody that
He's popped up in the CW universe, you know, the new guy that's playing him. He seems all right.
Yeah.
But it's going to be, I don't want to say it, but I'm going to say the W word, it will be. Yeah.
Oh, that's right. You hate that word, don't you? I don't like it very much.
No. It work. If you all want to come outside your house and protest, I don't care. You can all protest outside
my house. That's it. Oh, no. It's funny because I've been watching some of the old Not the 9 o'clock news from this week.
Yeah.
Oh dear! Oh, but they are bloody funny, I tell you. Even though they're made 40 years ago,
I know it's not quite science fiction, but have you seen the trailer for the new Spit and Image?
I'm interested in that. It'll either be really good or it looks like it's going to be a bit controversial, which the old series was.
Apparently it is, yeah. Britbox, though.
Okay, well, I'm sure that, as you say, these things will materialise. Yeah, it might sort of materialise on the monitor like these things tend to do.
As if by magic.
It is, like Paul Daniels is back from the dead kind of thing. I've mentioned Debbie McGee. But yeah, I'm interested in that. I hope it's... I mean, I've seen the puppets of, like, Trump and Boris Johnson and stuff, and that looks really quite funny. So, yeah, I'll certainly give it a go, and I'd like to certainly get your interest, your perspective of it when you've seen it. So
yes, and the man who uses the MF word, Samuel L. Jackson, is to star in a TV series, Nick Fury of the TV series.
All right. I've never seen Nick Fury in the first place, so it's gonna be like a TV.
Oh, you've seen Iron Man, yeah.
Oh yeah, I've seen Iron Man. Yeah.
Well, he's in Iron Man.
Oh, is he? I can't remember. Three years ago.
Right. Well, let's move on from that.
I'm going to watch that soon, and we'll have to do a show on Iron Man because it's one of your Marvel things, isn't it? So I'd like to.
Simon Pegg wrote a vampire film sequel to Shaun of the Dead, and it's brilliant.
Oh, I saw this week. I saw again the World's End with Simon Pegg.
Superb film. I like that.
I thought that was a good, fun film. That was a good film.
I think in some strange way, I think somebody can relate to somebody in that film. It's quite a sad film as well.
Yeah, people lost youth, isn't it, and how they're sort of
And that's what it's all about. Like, he's got all the mental health problems.
And he's still got his cassette tape from 19... The age group of that, when that came out, it was like the class of 89. That's my class.
Yes,
so that's the same year. So when I watch it, and especially now watching it again like 8 years later, I think to myself, God, I'm even older now. And it's quite poignant. And all the music, there's got a fantastic music soundtrack in that film.
Oh, my God.
And every single one of those songs
We should cover World's End, absolutely.
Yeah. That'd be a good one. Yeah. All right, okay.
Because there's a lot in that. There's a lot more in that film.
And it is science fiction, but it's clever because it doesn't start off like that. It just starts off like...
Because them have these so-called professional lives. None of them are happy, are they?
No, exactly.
Yeah, and that's what I liked about it.
Yeah. All right. I'll put that on the list, definitely. Yeah,
we've got some... from the Vulcan Reporter. Now, I don't know if this is right. Exclusive CBS All Access revives Khan prequel series Star Trek SETI Alpha.
Oh, SETI Alpha.
Oh, yes.
Well, SETI Alpha was of Khan. SETI Alpha 5 was where Khan was left, wasn't it, in space suit?
Yes. I have learned that CBS All Access intends to revive the previously cancelled Wrath of Khan Star Trek prequel series. Title SETI Alpha V, now removed article Geek Exchange, revealed that Nicholas Meyer was working on limited Trek series that takes place before the Wrath of Khan.
In between Space Seed and the Wrath of Khan, I suppose.
Yes.
Oh, that sounds interesting. Oh, that might be really good.
Well, according to the books, it was Gary Seven that got him off Earth in that ship. Area 51 in the books, what I read on Wikipedia about this, that when Khan's empire fell and everybody attacked,
How could Gary Seven be there?
Well, he was on Earth.
Oh, of course he was. I was thinking of Gary Mitchell. You mean Gary Seven? Yeah, I mean, he was around in the 60s.
Well, he took Khan and his followers, because apparently Khan was going to become he wanted him to become like him. But with what had happened, he got them all off the Earth in this ship they'd made with different alien technology in Area 51. They launched it, and that were it.
Right. Well, that sounds interesting.
That's in the Wikipedia. I don't know. But that is it canon, because it's in paperback. But apparently it would be interesting to see him ruling part of Earth and then escaping. I think that would be fascinating.
It would be. I mean, it would have to be. It's like an alternate 1996, which I think that's the year that he was supposed to take over.
Yeah.
It was 1997. I'm quite good with my knowledge of Star Trek. But then it was sort of changed, isn't it? In Enterprise, it was a bit later than that, because, of course, by the time they made Enterprise, it was after 1996 that they made that. So we know that the eugenics wars were in the 21st century. But, of course, yes, as we've gone on, real time has caught up. And, of course, it's not gone that way. So, but, yeah, that could be interesting. As long as they've got a good actor to play a young Khan. I'm up for that, definitely. I mean, I was going to say, the only thing I'm not that interested in at the moment is the Section 31 series. I'm a bit underwhelmed with that.
I'm not bothered about that.
Yeah, I'm not bothered about that at all. Go on, anyway,
I thought I'd be into the old Section 31.
I don't find it something I'm that interested in, really. I don't know.
Yeah. I just want them to go to different planets and explore the universe.
Well, yeah, they're going to do that, aren't they? Do you think now with the dreaded C word is still lingering around? Now, as far as I was aware, Discovery was supposed to be starting season 4 quite soon.
So
do you think it's all going to... I mean, is stuff in production now, or is it going to be halted again, or what do you think is going to happen?
I don't know. I've heard that they've all got a five-year contract, so...
Oh, good.
It's planned for a five-year run, isn't it? So,
oh, that'd be fantastic. We have 5 years. Yeah. I mean, there'll probably only be like 10 to 15 episodes per season, but even so, I mean, God, yeah. I could live with that, you know.
Definitely. I've got some news you'll be happy about. I've not read it, but it's in front of me.
Go on.
Seth MacFarlane offers hopeful The Orville Season 3 update.
Oh, okay. They stopped in March, didn't they?
We already know that Orville has been renewed for Season 3. However, we still don't know when we'll actually get to see it.
Yeah.
To see it. Luckily, Seth MacFarlane just offered a hopeful update on when the third series will begin production.
Oh, that's good. Well, let's hope that goes.
I thought they made it.
No, they did 6 episodes, and it was March, and they stopped. They stopped in mid, and that's why it's all got buggered, basically. 6 episodes in, and they couldn't go any further, and of course it's messed everything up for everybody, which of course is...
So we're not going to get this till next year, then?
No. I mean, we probably won't get... I mean, we've got the Doctor Who at Christmas, and then we probably won't get any Doctor Who to 2022, I reckon, the way it's going. They're not even doing production of that, and it takes about a year to do that, and it's already October tomorrow from our recording date.
I think they want to be careful there, you know.
Why that?
Because I find that when they start moving stuff around and cancelling it for a year and all this, just lose interest.
I do think Doctor Who is on its way out, and I don't think the COVID is helping. You know, it does remind me of the last years, John Nathan Turner, Sylvester McCoy years, where you could tell that it was past its prime. For me, it was. I mean, I don't dislike Sylvester McCoy, but
to see a new Doctor.
Well, it always shakes things up a bit. But I mean, Jodie's supposed to have one more year. I mean, I don't know. I don't know, really.
I think it's at the end now. It's had a good run. I mean, it's been around for
15
what?
Years.
Yeah, I mean, quite. It's had a bloody good run. And how many doctors? We've had 4 doctors
We had five.
Oh, yeah, Eccleston, yeah.
And it has been really good. And I've got my custom-made DVD collection, and I'm looking at the first to the 13th Doctors. And you know, it's brilliant because it wasn't a reboot, it was a direct continuation. Everything fitted, I'm very, very pleased with it. And I'll be really sad when it finishes, but hopefully it'll finish with a point where I think, well, we'll be back in a few years' time or something. We'll come back. And
I'd like to say, get a really, if it goes out like the best season they've done. And it goes out on an amazing, like, bang. You know, something that it's worthy of, you know?
But I don't think the BBC are really supporting it anymore. I mean, they've moved it from the Christmas Day slot, which is one of the big things at Christmas for all of us. And it's on New Year's, which is not the same. And again, and each year, well, most seasons it's getting, like, an episode shorter. And it just doesn't feel as grand anymore. It just doesn't feel quite right.
It was like Torchwood Elder the screwed that over as well.
Slowly, it's slowly falling apart, I think.
Yeah, Torchwood, when that started, I thought the first season was just excellent. And then its second season started killing all the cast off.
Yeah, yeah.
And I thought, what are you doing?
No.
And then I'm a big fan of Children of Earth. I thought that was a massive.
No, I never saw it.
All right, well, I won't give you any spoilers. I do recommend you should watch it. And then they teamed up with some American TV stars, I think it was. And it were like a load of episodes of rubbish.
Right, yeah.
And it was a shame. It was such a shame, really. Really was. But The Children of Earth, it will freak you out. That's all I'm going to say. It's worth a look, trust me.
Okay, okay. So, yeah, let's do, like I said, I don't know. If we get one more season, Doctor Who.
That's the news. So it's looking like we're not going to get it till next year.
No. Well, like I said, it's a shame. But apparently, they can't even do like release half a season because the episodes aren't filmed in subsequential order. Mm. So they can't sort of like show episodes 1 to 6 like a half season or something. Because there's obviously some plot line or something which goes through it.
Yeah, the story arc, yeah.
So, yeah, so it's a great shame. So,
Season 2 set up the story arc with the invasion with the robot people and that, didn't it? It set up what they call Isaac's Race.
Well, it's strange, really, because with the Orville, I mean, it's not many series I've watched where I watch something and I think, OK, this is something so good. Obviously, I've had it with the Star Treks. I've had it with the Stargates, and I've had it with the Mandalorian. But the Orville, as well, when I watched some of those late season 2 episodes, I thought, right, okay, these guys, they know what they're doing. They're doing definitely what our Star Trek fans want. And I'm not going on about the CBS Star Treks. We all know that, you know, it's got some issues and stuff. But the Orville, to me, just felt like it was like the 6th series Star Trek series. In many ways, like in an alternate timeline or something.
Yeah.
And that's the way I felt with it. So, you know, we just have to wait. You know, this year's been the waiting game already, so we just have to wait a bit longer. So we'll have to see what happens. All right, Martin, well, thanks for that. Unfortunately, my computer's frozen, so I can't go into the lead into the Orville or find your space sounds, but we'll try and do those as the show goes on. So let's go into the focus of the week. Here we go.
It's the Solar Sci-Fi Focus of the Week.
All right, so this is a film which I think was made, like I said, my details aren't up, but it was made in about, when was it made? Early 2000s? Something like that.
Yeah, I'd say about 2008, wasn't it?
Something like that. And it was another version of the film which was The Amiga Man with Charlton Heston, and there was another one as well with Vincent Price. So, like I said, I'll be firing a lot more information in front of you, but I've just got a white screen at the moment with the computer humming, which is a bit annoying. So tell me what you thought about it when you saw about it. How did you hear about it?
I did. I had a friend who used to call it I Am Legend.
Why?
I don't know, Legend. He just called it I Am Legend. It's... He used to always call it. Have you seen I Am Legend? It came into my head now, and it's got nothing to do.
But it's something.
But
stuck
it
in
just
your head.
Came into my mind. Yeah, there's two endings.
Right? I know. That, right? There are two endings.
I quite like I Am Legends. I really did like it. You got a lot of backstory about the pandemic.
Yes.
And yes, I quite like that. And the evacuation and how everything falling apart and he got left behind and his relationship with the dog and stuff like that. And his loneliness. When the first night in film when he locks himself in the bathroom and turns all the lights off and just sits curled up in the bathroom, they're all outside screaming and
that's right. It's creepy, isn't it? It's really creepy.
Yeah, that really... I think that touched it for me in that film, that moment.
Yeah, it's strange because I was so familiar with the version before with Charlton Heston. But I did like this one as well. It was different, but it's still it had an impact about it, and I liked his character. I liked the fact that, I mean, there were some interesting little jokes. There was a somewhere like a poster. It had like Batman versus Superman or something.
Yes,
like,
it somewhere. Fitted in the background.
And that was done as like an in-joke kind of thing. But it was solid. It was a solid film. It's probably watching it now, especially when they're trying to make a vaccine for cancer. And of course, it was the vaccine that caused the issues with the film. Which caused the deformity, or what was it? Or how do you describe it? It was almost like
like sort of zombie vampire type.
They were alive, weren't they? But I mean,
they couldn't come out in the sunlight, though, could they?
They were very, and that's right. And literally, if the sunlight hits them, they would burn. Literally, would burn. Which is strange.
But there was this. It's like they were developing like their own culture as well when people were changing.
Yeah.
They were like evolving from that form as well, because that obviously goes in with other ending. But it were pretty weird, because one of them were quite intelligent. Though when they were attacking where they lived, one of them were quite a bit, seemed a bit clever. You kept seeing him, like
they were clever. And they even set a trap for the cat for Neville as well, didn't they? They actually
yeah, they did.
So they were clever. They just acted in a way which is almost like another evolution or of humanity, but in a weird way, in a way where they don't sort of have language and stuff. They're more kind of like barbaric, but they also have their own methods and their own ways of doing stuff. I did think it was very good. I it's funny because I only watched the alternative ending about a year ago, and I mean, are you glad with the ending that they went with, first of all? The original ending.
It's from what I can remember, he sacrifice himself at the end. Right, but in the second ending, he survived, didn't he?
He did survive. They went off together.
Well, I would have liked to have seen him survive in the official ending. I'm an optimist.
That's interesting.
The Charlton Heston one. Obviously, we'll go into that, but. Because it were made at that time, I would have liked to have seen him survive.
Yeah.
I really would have done. I think that's what they should have done. I was a bit annoyed because it had been done in the Omega Man, and to me, there were no point copying it.
Yeah, it's interesting, actually. I hadn't really thought about that, but I suppose it's in many ways that they did copy the fact that he sort of gave up his life to save humanity kind of thing. I didn't mind. I don't know, it's weird when you have a downbeat ending, but it's supposed to be a sort of poignant ending, isn't it? That's the whole point. And it, in some ways it means that, you know, he was his only survivor with his dog, and of course because he managed to find a way of stopping them, but he had to die for them. It's a strange one. What did you think of the girl in it, the character? I think she was like a Latino or something, wasn't she? She was like Spanish or something, wasn't she?
Yes, I thought she was all right. I liked it where they all went and where they built that compound at the end with the big machine guns. And
yeah.
Thought that way, it made a lot of sense.
Yeah.
I thought she was all right. I mean, it's just basically it's a rehash of the Omega Man, isn't it? I mean, and I know they had more to it with science and technology and that, which, and they did. I like the background where it all started.
Yeah. Well,
I thought it added that's what I liked about it.
Well, what I'm going to do is we are going to talk about the Omega Man a bit with this one, but I think that film is strong enough that we could do a separate show on that one on its own.
Oh, definitely.
But I will say that I did prefer the Omega Man to this version, but I also thought this one was good as well. Which one did you prefer?
I was just about to ask you that. Which one did you prefer?
Oh, the Omega Man. When I watched it, it's one of those films that I've never forgotten. It was everything about it. And Charlton Heston, who, of course, I had already seen in such great films like Planet of the Apes and Soylent Green and things like that. So, you know, you're already there with an actor of that caliber.
I like Will Smith, but I think Charlton Heston had more. I don't know.
I think there were
more about Charlton.
Charlton Heston's Neville, to me, he had something more stronger about it, something a bit more heroic than. Yeah. But I mean, don't get me wrong, the other Neville was good, but I just felt that And also, I think, you know, with that version, the Amiga Man, it was when it was made, and the music and the what were they called, the people in the robes? They had the family, weren't they? They called the family, I think they were called. They were good. And this is a problem with the newer version, which one of my main issues, which, of course, they could in many ways even fix at some point. The subhuman characters were all CGI, and the CGI itself wasn't that good. Now, it was all right, but were you bothered with the CGI? Did it make it, were you indifferent to it, or how did you feel?
I watched a couple of clips of it when you mentioned this on YouTube, and it is pretty naff, isn't it?
Yeah, that's the problem with it, I think.
It is pretty.
They could have done it with sort of practical, but they could have done it in a way that they could have added some CGI to the movement and sort of had more of a balance rather than pure CGI.
But again, like the family in the Amiga Man's got more power.
But exactly why I thought about saying that.
Is it like the father of them?
Yeah.
Sat behind his desk with sunglasses.
Anthony Zerb was the character in that one.
Yeah,
and he was brilliant.
Got more power than the CGI versions.
That's the problem. That is the major issue. They should have done the same. I mean, it was also with the Thing prequel. They did CGI with that as well. Although I didn't mind the Thing prequel. No, I didn't either. I've always said that. We actually have to focus. Actually, we've got to do a show on the Thing as well. But going back to I'm Legend, that was one of the major factors, I think, which was a negative for the film. We didn't see them too much, and when he did, they were very CGI is always very quick glimpses of them running by, because every second that you do a CGI, it costs thousands and thousands of dollars or whatever to make it and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But I think that was a factor as well. But I still thought it was a solid film. I still think
it is a good film. But you see, the problem is, like with the Omega Man, you got the epic ending, where he's like on the cross with his blood going into
the blood of the water, yes.
Which is now gonna
biblical kind
cure
of thing.
Everybody.
Yeah, exactly.
And the family don't know that's coming. But with him, when he died, no, he sacrificed himself and he did the big thing. But he was like Planet of the Apes, Tim Burton's version. Sometimes they try to copy the endings of a film, they just alter it, but they think they're gonna get that impact. I think there would have been better where he got away with them people and lived in that compound. And I think that would have put I Am Legend in its own area. And I think that when he died at the end, I think that was a mistake.
Yeah, I can
because
see your point.
Because you can't after Heston on the in the fountain. That is very powerful symbolism.
Yes, it was. It was very powerful. It was so well done. It, like I said, it's strange. It's a strange one. But
it's like films like the original Planet of the Apes. You got it's been voted the best ending ever of a movie, and then Tim Burton's one, which I don't mind it actually, but the ending's terrible. Like they tried to do that big ending, it's going to do your head in. Well, instead, just create your own ending. Do something original. Don't mimic something from a classic, because think you're going to get that reaction. Doesn't work. Create your own ending.
Yeah,
that's my opinion. But I Am Legend is a good film. I've got it on Blu-ray. It's a bloody good film.
Yeah, it is a good film. I suppose it's a wonder whether they could have done some sort of sequel to it or something, but I think really they couldn't.
There were rumours of a prequel, weren't there? They were going to go.
Oh, that would be interesting.
Did you remember that?
Yeah, I did hear about that. Yeah, but I remember something about that. No, it never materialised, did they?
A TV series could work, you know.
Yeah, actually, that could work, couldn't it?
I think it could today. I know you've seen the zombies one. I've only seen
28, Walking Dead.
Walking Dead.
You got to watch that. You got to watch that. That is a good series.
I mean. It's
really good series.
You could say I Am Legend along down that path.
Yeah, I could see that.
Different, but I think it could work, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope it gets done. But like I said, I mean, sometimes a TV version doesn't work, but it's definitely got the, you know, the premise. And of course, they could do the CGI, it'd be better now because it's 10, 15 years since they made the film. Yeah, I could see that working.
Yeah, well, I Am Legend, I think, is either the third or fourth film based on that book.
Yeah. Now, did you see the Vincent Price one?
I've seen bits of it, yeah.
Yeah, music. I've seen it. It was all right, but it was definitely the weakest of the three, I thought. Yeah. Recently it was, the full film was on YouTube, and it's been colourised. So,
years ago, I saw it on BBC Two. It was in the horror thing. You know what they used to do? They used to put Hammer movies on.
Yeah.
No, it was on that. They always have like one of them dodgy black and white movies on. It were on, but they've colourised it.
It was colourised, yeah. I didn't mind it being colourised, quite frankly. But I mean,
I find that when they colourised old black and white movies, looks a bit odd.
It's like I'm a big Lauren Hardy fan, and I've got the coloured versions as well as the black and white
ones.
I prefer the black. Lauren Hardy's gonna be black and white. I mean,
up on that, yeah.
But I love Lauren Hardy, and it's such a shame that people now don't, you know, it's not really that well known. Sorry, I know we're going slightly off topic for a second, but I just want to say that I love Lauren Hardy. And if you get the chance, see the recent movie which features Steve Coogan.
I've seen it.
Did you like it? I thought it was good. I thought it was really good. I thought it was really good. Really good.
I loved it.
Yeah. So, like I said, going back to the Vincent Price version, colorized versions of stuff don't always work.
Right.
You know, like I said, it depends. I mean, because I'm not that familiar with it, I can watch the colorized
version. Does he die at the end of that one then?
I can't remember.
Because he's amazing, isn't he? I mean, Vincent Price, great actor. And then you've got Will Smith, but I'm a big fan of Will Smith.
Yeah, me too. I like Will Smith.
It still comes out that the Omega Man still tops it.
The Omega Man is far above the other two. It was just, like I said, we'll do a separate episode on that. But
definitely.
Yeah, and it was just brilliant. But I would sort of clarify or finish off this topic to say that, it was a really great film. I've watched it many times over the years. And the last time I actually pranked my wife because she'd seen it years and years ago and I just got the Blu-ray. And I decided as a joke to put on the alternative ending. She watched it. And it's a couple of days. Yeah. I don't remember that happening like that before. It's really funny. I was watching like the bit with it. And it was really funny because she was looking like, what? That's a great thing about that Blu-ray because you can play it and it's not obvious that you're watching the alternative. And what she did, I was selecting the menus when she was outside and I pressed play. Yeah. And of course she didn't realise. So it's quite funny. But yeah, it's funny when you see a film that you well know and it alternative ending.
I went to see Evil Dead number 3.
Never seen Evil Dead.
Well, I saw it at the cinema, Bruce Campbell.
Right.
The third one. And I went to the cinema, it's the Army of Darkness, that's it. And the ending was totally different. Because when I got it on VHS, they had another ending. And I kept telling people, I said, I saw this at cinema, it had another ending. And it wasn't until when DVD came out, both endings were on.
Oh, well, I think it doesn't always, I mean, sometimes they change things. Like, we've been watching Only Fools and Horses, and that's hacked to bits. That is changed, all the music's changed because of the copyright laws and stuff like that. And a lot of it's missing, a lot of it's cut out. You know, it's funny that you always expect a film to be the same whenever you get it in a different format.
Yes.
It doesn't necessarily mean it's going to happen. I think a lot of films do stay in their format. But like with Star Wars, where every time they re-release Star Wars, it's in a different thing. There's another CGI alien in the background and there's another scene here. And it's like there's about 15 different versions of Star Wars now. You know, so it's a strange one. But yeah, I'm Legend, a classic. I'm really glad that you liked it. I'm really glad that I've seen it. I'm sure sooner or later they'll make a new version of it. I can see that happening. Whether they can make I don't know. Do you think they'd ever make a fourth version of it? I mean, they may.
No, we've had three versions now. It's time to move on.
I mean, we've had four versions of Invasions of the Body Snatchers, so it's possible.
Four?
Yeah, we have.
Oh, yeah, the Nicole Kidman.
Which was, that was the biggest pile of shite I've ever seen in my life.
Oh, God, that would tell it. Well, yeah. Oh, that.
Oh, God. Yeah. And Invasion of the Body Snatchers 78 is probably one of my all-time favourite films ever.
Yeah, you sent me one that I watched, which I found quite
Body Snatchers was good. Yeah. The one in 1993, I like that one a lot.
I've never seen that. I
told you about it. Yeah, I thought it was very solid. We could even do a review of that at some point. I think it's worth it.
I think we did review it. I think we have reviewed it.
We've not done a whole show on it because I would have remembered it in the graphics. We've talked about it.
Okay.
But we could have.
It was good, that, though.
It was good.
I don't
know
how that got past me.
No, I heard about it, and of course, because I love the 78 version and the 56 version. But I'm sorry, we're going on a tangent again tonight.
Yes.
But yeah, anyway, I'm Legend. I think we'll finish this one. Good film. CGI could be a bit better. I mean, I think they should re-release it now, completely update the CGI, and I think that might help it a little bit, make it... Otherwise, it's going to really date it in say, 10, 15 years' time. Because, like I said, the CGI is so cartoonish that it does affect the enjoyment a bit of the film as the antagonists, i.e. the survivors. Whereas, of course, the Omega Man's version, it's just as good now as it was in the 1970s when it was made. So. Right, thank you for that, Martin. I think that's pretty much done. Are you ready for cancelled? Nay, it's here to stay. Planet of the Apes Part 2. Are you ready?
The TV series.
Here we go. Cancelled? Nay.
I'm going to hear lots of static.
It's here to stay. Right, do you want to refresh where we got up to with your...
Right, well let's jump ahead a bit. So our heroes, Verdon, Burke and Galen, are on the run, and they came up to the end of the Ape Nation. General Urko's in pursuit with his bunch of apes, and they head across into the Forbidden Zone. Galen's getting really scared. They met the Underdwellers. There was a bit of an adventure. They were still worshipping a nuclear bomb, but they were going to launch it on the Ape Nation.
Right.
Verdon and Burke, because they're both scientists, and disabled the bomb and showed that the Underdwellers were wrong, and they escaped from there, and they go further on into the Negative Zone. So, yeah.
Right.
They're running with the backpacks on as usual. Not the clothes are still spotless. You know, I don't know. They must be stinking by now. But they're running across the desert, Galen, and they come into this valley.
Right.
Right. And Urko's just got permission to cross in, and Zaius has gone with them now as well. And they're like 6 days behind, right? So they end up in this valley. It's like they find a cave and they go through, and there's a valley there, and it's like a jungle. It's all lush and it's paradise, and they get caught in these traps, and the place is called Uapia, right?
Uapia.
Uapia, yeah. It's where there's two lots of humans in it. The humans are like, they're equal.
Okay.
And they broke off, this society broke off from the apes 1,000 years ago. And they've got a settlement there, and they're quite advanced. They've got electricity, right?
Okay.
They've got a bit more technology, steam technology and all this. And humans in there, they're equal. And so Verdon and Bert are resting up, and you know, Urko's in pursuit. But there is a bit of a twist, because there's somebody there in this like town. The Lawgiver's there.
Oh, okay. The Lawgiver.
The Lawgiver.
Ah, okay.
And they meet the Lawgiver, or a descendant of the Lawgiver line. And he tells them about what happened to the human race, and how things got all turned upside down. And that they broke off. Originally, the Lawgiver wanted man and human to live together. And they went there. And Zaius knows about these people, but it's all kept in.
Sort of like a secret thing.
Yeah, because you know what they're like. And they go there. But there's dark forces at work in the jungle and this place. Everything is not what it seems.
Okay, so is this something which will take a while to discover what this other element is, or how would it go from there?
Well, there's a vault there.
Okay.
With all the human technology.
Oh. So they've got all their things like TVs and computers and all sorts of things.
Oh, that, yeah.
And guns and okay.
And the thing is, in this place, they won't let anybody near the knowledge, because it's the Lawgiver. They don't want to release the technology on the world.
Because they're frightened about what happened like in the past.
Yeah. And Burke, he has that disc, which he's going to put into a computer to get themselves back.
Right.
And they break in, went into the vault to break in, because they're from the futuristic time. they get the computer working and it tells them that there could be another ship.
I was just about to ask that. What if they found another ship which is actually intact? That they've got the information from the computer to work out how to get back to their correct time. That could be really interesting. Wow.
Well, they find out that there's another bunker somewhere, like it's like 500 miles away across the Forbidden Zone. They've got to leave this place. So they get a sailing like thing on wheels and they go across, they leave this town. But Urko finds him and he starts butchering the apes and the humans in this town. And the lawgiver goes with them and some of the people. They escape because the apes just burn it. Because, like, you know, treating humans equally. Urko comes in, they massacre a lot of them.
Right.
It's a massacre. And they escape through, like, this other entrance out of this valley. And Zaius is freaking out, you know. And the apes are put on trial while the humans are all burned to death. And they escape. But when they went in his vault, they found they got hold of some weapons, like some laser guns. And they cleared off him, the lawgiver, the descendant of the lawgiver, his follower, who's an ape at North Marshall Arts. And they all go running off because there's another colony somewhere at the other side of the Forbidden Zone. And they're running across, right? So it goes like 3-4 days to get away from Urko. And Urko's freaking out because it's like everything against their society, these two groups of people living together.
Yeah.
And they set up a camp, just Verdun, Burke and Galen, and the descendant of the lawgiver. And they look up in the sky and they see a light in the sky.
Right.
Something comes
Something's coming, okay.
And that, well.
Is that the end of part two kind of thing?
That's the end of part two.
Yeah.
Well, where would you like to?
Well, honestly, I was thinking about this story. I mean, I'm not detracting from your story, but I was also thinking about, I mean, Earth is still Earth, and you've got to wonder where, say, what's happening in Europe. Whether, you know, I mean, do you think apes? No. But would the apes have actually be in other parts of the world? You know, would they over the?
It's a good question.
You know, because you think about it. I mean, obviously, apes were a very large population. They're obviously predominantly in North America in the setting of where these films were.
Yeah.
And I was just wondering where, you know, if, like, would they be a worldwide thing, or whether, you know, humans might be primitive in, like, Europe or...
But Galen, Verdun and Burke, and they can't go running to Europe.
No, I know that. I was just curious about what you think the rest of the world would be like, whether it's just a wasteland and it's just in this part of where the apes films have always been based, where that's the only life that there really is. You know what I mean?
Yeah, well, there must be. There must, because they are scared of water, though, aren't they? They're not really into water, are they? So
I can't remember that. I didn't know that.
I don't think so, yeah. But you're right, because the world got destroyed, didn't it? And there was apes back in the day. But, yeah, what's in Europe? I mean, is there other creatures living in the...
Well, I mean, you might have wondered whether evolution... I mean, because in the apes films, of course, all the dogs and cats and everything died, didn't they?
Yeah, they did.
But that was an alternate timeline, wasn't it? I get confused.
But there's other things in the negative zone, not just apes and humans.
What else is there, then?
Well, you'll find out next week.
Oh, okay, all right. It's to be continued. Oh God, he's really good this week, isn't he? Good. I mean, that's obviously interesting. I mean, are you sort of like thinking ahead each week and sort of making, or are you going off the?
I've got a plan. Yeah, I've got a plan. I'm going to get him back to Earth because when they edited certain apes episodes into like TV movies, they got Roddy McDowell back to do an intro beginning of each one, and there's one where he's sat in front of a fire with baby little chimps, and he says he starts telling his children about his past adventures, and he said they found the computer and it got them back home.
Wow, yeah, brilliant.
So that's where we're going to get Verdun and Burke back home. You and I are going to finally get them back home
after they got lost. When was it made, the TV series? In the mid 70s,
I think. It was the 70s, wasn't it?
Was it 70s, I think. Yeah, because it was I think the first Planet of the Apes film was like 1967 or something. Then they made them every 2 years. They made five of those. And then I know that the TV series was done after the last movie, I think.
Yes.
So, yeah, that's interesting. Okay, brilliant. I think that's a really good one. Thank you for that. And I'm certainly glad that you're a big Planet of the Apes fan. And I've got to watch the new remakes again soon. I've not seen them for ages. But I remember they were quite good.
I wasn't too impressed with the third one.
That was the last one,
wasn't it?
I liked
it. It was just a bit disappointing.
Yeah, but it was a bit of a build-up, I suppose. So,
Well, the second one was marvellous.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, but the third one, well, I don't know what I expected something big with the third one, but...
No, I know, it's strange. All right, thanks for that. I think, to be honest with you, I don't know, I can't think of anything else much to sort of, like, focus on tonight, really.
It's one of them weeks, I think.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, it's been interesting what we've been talking about, but I will leave, though, with an interesting thing. So this is something which... this is a slightly shorter episode than normal, but there's just... bear with us, folks, because sometimes you just have a week where there's not much. Are we going to have any more guests on soon? Is there anybody else that you want to bring on soon?
I've asked a friend, I've asked if she wants to come on.
Okay, brilliant. Well, let me know about that.
It's working out the time frames.
Yeah, yeah. I think
Daniel wants to come on. I know Daniel wants to come on.
Okay, well, yeah, I mean, if you know Daniel...
You spoke to him. He was on my live shows. He pops up. He sends me a lot of...
Oh, okay.
Messages about stuff. He wants to come on, but I have asked him before, but he's like the tie. He lives in Canada, so I mean, Daniel, if you're tuning in, we'd like you to come on. Massive Discovery fan.
Oh yeah, well, to be honest with you, I was thinking about this. We've got to have a pre-Discovery. Do you want to, in a couple of weeks before Discovery season 3 starts, we will have a focus of the week on Discovery?
Yeah, I'd like to. What? Yeah, like with the Friday night thing, I've got to work. See, I don't know what's best to do. Do we record the show?
Well,
or do it live?
I think it depends on who is free and what's best for you. I mean, what I was thinking we could do is we could do it like the normal podcast here, base it on Discovery of what we thought of the first two seasons. Then we could do your live stuff or pre-recorded YouTube stuff with me on whoever else you want.
Yeah, well, I was going to try and get 3 or 4 of us onto the Zoom channel.
Yeah, I've got to learn a bit more about Zoom. I know you can just download it. So.
Well, we'll have to sort this out because we're 2 weeks away now.
Yeah, we should. I want to make sure I want to make sure that when we do it, we're all out fair and know how it all works.
Yeah,
and
there's time differences. I'd like Trek fan to come on as well.
I've not heard from Trek fan for a couple of weeks. Robert, so I hope he's all doing all right. He said he's quite busy doing stuff as well. So
all right, it's fair enough. But it would be good to get him on. And Daniel, my friend Chelsea, she's getting into Star Trek now. Just started from original services. I think she's into Voyager now.
Oh, wow. So she's got through a lot of it.
Really hungry for it, you know. So
as you watch it, obviously in order as well. So
Okay. Well, Enterprise that got her hooked.
Well, so did she watch the original, then Enterprise, then the Next Gen, then DS9, then Voyager? She's watching.
No, I think she's been jumping at different. She's watched the original series, but she started with Enterprise, and then she just started jumping on.
Oh, they're all good. They're all good. I love them.
Yeah.
All
so, and I'd like to get her because she never bothered with it before. Now she's hooked.
Well, that's good. That's good.
Yeah.
Right. Well, look, let's finish off today. Now I'm going to talking about Star Trek. This is the last time, I promise.
Oh, not
no!
Him.
No! It's not. It's a twist. It's a twist. No! But it is. Obviously, we know YouTuber X39457, aka Professor Q, with his wonderful songs. And you're going to kill me for this. I thought, if he could do it, why can't I do it? So I was trying to think of a song to sing to make up the lyrics to, and it's not a sci-fi film or TV series. Do you know what I found? And it only lasts 30 seconds, and that's it, I promise, okay? I did Henry's Cat. Remember the old cartoon from the 80s, Henry's Cat?
Oh, I'm not even going to swear.
Well, you can.
I'm not going to swear. I'm not going to do it.
Shall I press play?
I've got a gun, and I'm just going to point it to my head.
Okay, well, if it goes quiet afterwards, then I know
you pulled the trigger.
I can hear beeps at the moment, so maybe that'll be the... Okay, here we go. This is terrible.
Henry's cat, Henry's cat, Henry's cat, Henry's cat, that
It's what is called. That is what is called.
Henry's Cat. Henry's Cat. Henry's Cat.
That is what it's.
Oh,
I messed it up at the end.
No, I send you the noises of the universe. Gobs
and you, I send you Henry's Cat. And I still can't load up the thing to get the noise.
I send you the noises of the universe, the pillars of God out in a galaxy somewhere. And they've got the recordings of the noises that come from it. And you go and do that.
I know, but I had to do it. I don't know. Well, tell you what I'll do is, because like I said, I have real major issues with the computer all night. It's been whirring and doing nothing. I've not been able to play your noise of the universe. So shall we, like, fade into the noises of the universe and then fade out from our chatting? Is that all right?
Oh, why don't you mix it all together? Henry's Cat and Noises of the Universe. Say what comes out.
Oh, God. So we're going to fade out now with Henry's Cats, okay? And mixed in with that is Noises of the Universe, which I've not heard yet because the effing computer's not working. We'll catch you next week on the Solo One Sci-Fi Podcast. Thanks for tuning in. Bye-bye.
Live long and prosper.
Bye-bye.
That is what he's called. That is what he's called.
Henry's Cat. Henry's Cat. Henry's Cat.
That is what it's. Oh, but. Okay.